quiet, numbskulls. I'm broadcasting.
The medical marijuana. The medical marijuana. Radio. Radio. Show.
The medical marijuana for you and me. Ah, yeah, the medical marijuana. Whoa, 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 yeah, the medical. It's the medical marijuana show. You knew we know.
I want to talk to you.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome to another edition of Medical Marijuana Radio. This one is for October 1st, 2016, and I'm your host, Larry Love. We're here every week to bring you the latest information on medical use of cannabis and adult use and legalization from all over the globe. This week, I have two guests in separate interviews regarding the Arizona legalization of 205 in Arizona. It's very controversial, and we're going to talk all about that. They're trying to possibly legalize here in New Mexico in the short session. I don't know how that's going. I was trying to read that bill last night, and it was just eye blurry. And but first, before we talk to David Wisniewski and Jason Medar, I've got news for you.
I've got news for you.
And staying with the theme of legalization, this article is from Marijuana World News. These three states may vote against legalizing marijuana this fall. With national pollster Gallup's latest poll showing support nationwide for legalization at 58% and CBS News poll in 2015 showing 84% support legalization, these states, however, are having some problems, and mostly it's due to the way they're written. Arizona, which we'll be talking about in a few minutes, all eyes are going to be on Proposition 205 in Arizona, which received more than 250,000 signatures to get on the November ballot. If approved, adults age 21 and up would be able to possess up to 1 ounce of marijuana, grow up to 6 plants, and consume marijuana in non-public places. Recreational marijuana would carry a 15% tax rate. And we'll be talking about why most people should vote no in Arizona in just a few minutes. Another state is Massachusetts. It's a toss-up in Massachusetts, which is bringing question 4 to its residents in about 5 weeks. If approved, Massachusetts would allow 21 and over to possess up to 1 ounce of marijuana, have up to 10 ounces in their homes, and grow up to 6 plants. In terms of taxation, regulation and taxation of the Marijuana Act, as it's officially known, would add 3.75% tax on top of the state's 6.25 sales tax. And then local taxes could be up to an additional 2%. So that's Massachusetts, and I'll try to get somebody on in the next week or so to see what the advocates say there. And then, of course, finally, there's North Dakota. Residents of North Dakota will go to the polls in November to vote on the North Dakota Compassionate Care Act, which would legalize medical marijuana in the state. Also known as Measure 5, the act would allow possession of up to 3 ounces of cannabis for qualifying conditions such as cancer, glaucoma, epilepsy, AIDS, and would allow residents to grow up to 8 plants if they live more than 40 miles from a licensed dispensary within the state. Now, that's some crappy rules like they have in Arizona with their their medical program where they have a 25-mile rule. So that doesn't fly. That's not good. And so we'll see if we can get somebody from North Dakota in a couple of weeks. But first, we have other news. As you know, we have our presidential jokey election coming up in a few weeks. Here is Chelsea Clinton, who misspoke this week on the risks of marijuana. Okay, and I think she's done a little turnaround since then. But here's Chelsea. It's a short one.
But we also have anecdotal evidence now from Colorado where some of the people who were taking marijuana for those purposes, the coroner believes after they died there was drug interactions with other things they were taking. And so one of the reasons we really do need rigorous studying, to your point about rescheduling marijuana, is one, we want to know where it works and it doesn't work.
I think we know where it works and where it doesn't work. I think I read an article this week about how the United States has been funding Israel for 50 years in Dr. Meshulam's work. So, you know, there's the hypocrisy again that the United States government has. Saturday Night Live star Pete Davidson, who's a young guy, I think he's maybe 21 years old, fantastic, very funny guy. Here's a little interview from High Times, their website. They interviewed him, talking about how pot helps his Crohn's disease. This is Pete Davidson, and don't forget to watch Saturday Night Live tonight, beginning of the new season, and they're going to be obviously doing a whole thing on the Trump-Clinton debate. So here is Pete Davidson about Crohn's.
Hey, what's up, guys? It's Pete Davidson, and I am at High Times right now, and I'm having a very good time. I am a pothead. I don't think, like, that's my type of comedy, but it's definitely, like, a huge part of my life. And I got Crohn's disease, like, when I was, like, 17 or 18, and I found that the medicines that the doctors were prescribing me and seeing all these doctors and trying new things, weed would be the only thing that would help me eat. My stomach would just be in pain all day and I wouldn't be able to eat, and then I'd smoke and I'd be able to eat and be able to do my shows, and I wouldn't be able to do SNL if I didn't smoke weed. I wouldn't be able to do anything, really. Me performing not high has gone awful. It's awful for me because I don't feel well. I can perform not high, but like it wouldn't be that much fun for me. You know, I'd be like in a lot of pain before shows, and you know, I smoke a joint and then immediately I could, you know, do this. I know it's like weird, everybody's offended today, but I kind of do get a little like offended, like when people are just like, you know, oh, you're just a pothead watching cartoons. Like I work really fucking hard and I take care of my shit, and like, you know, I need weed in order to do that because, you know, I'm sick, I have Crohn's, so it sucks, you know, and like, smoking weed allows me to do that, so I feel like that makes a lot of sense. I feel like it does. Like, I'm not that smart, but like that, like I'm gonna go home later and be like, you know, I said that one thing and that was good. No, I've been waiting 3 years to say something and I think this is the time. No, just please watch my special. I think it's okay. I don't know. Comedy Central, October 29th at 10 p.m. with limited commercial interruption. But, you know, like if I had to give an honest review, I'd be like 68 on Rotten Tomatoes or something like that. But I think you might like it. So check it out.
So that's Pete Davidson from Saturday Night Live who uses, he says weed. You know, I used to call it weed back in the day, and I still do sometimes. It's in our heads. But he's using cannabis to help his Crohn's disease, and we know how devastating Crohn's can be. We're going to move around the country a little bit before we talk about Arizona. In Florida, the Catholic bishops are weighing in on the marijuana vote. Catholic bishops, here we go.
Catholic bishops are getting involved in the push to legalize medical marijuana in Florida. The team supporting Amendment 2 has raised $1 million more than opponents. But the no team has a lot more money left to spend, about $1 million. Yes team, just $100,000. Now Florida's Catholic bishops are warning voters about the effects on kids. NBC2 anchor Chad Oliver in our control room with the new details.
Peter, good evening. The bishops are warning Amendment 2 could make pot more available to kids, and also that pot candy could end up in kids' digestive system and send more children to the hospital. The bishops are afraid passing the medical marijuana bill will lead to drug abuse, insisting Amendment 2 does not require specific dosages. Bishops are also concerned the bill will now allow marijuana to be in the edible form, leading to children accidentally ingesting the drug and getting sick. Despite serious reservations, though, the group isn't quite ready to completely oppose the measure either.
The bishops, being informed by, you know, the experience of caring for the sick and the suffering, want to make sure that, you know, people are aware of the concerns as they weigh whether to support it or oppose it.
You just heard from Michael Sheedy. He is with the Florida Conference of Catholic Bishops. Amendment 2 failed by a thin margin 2 years ago and is polling well heading into November. The No on 2 campaign is ready to ramp up their attacks on medical marijuana. An estimated $1 million in television advertising set to hit the airwaves in October. Chad Oliver, NBC 2.
So that's Florida. Moving over to California. California has... I guess it's called Prop 64. It's ALMA, the Adult Use Marijuana Act. And it's very controversial. No one really knows if it's going to pass or not yet. Sean Parker put a lot of money behind it. It's got some bad things in it. It's got some good things in it. It's better than what's going on now. I've personally talked to an activist, Todd McCormick, who's a great guy and been an activist and was involved with Jack Herer and the Emperor Wears No Clothes book and so forth. So he convinced me that at least as far as California is concerned, it's best to vote yes on 64 to legalize it, and then which would help all the bad stuff that's going on, but would have to be sort of worked on and changed for the future. But here is a spot, it's about 2 minutes, on yes on California, and tells you why.
As long as marijuana is illegal, it will be used to criminalize people of color.
Blacks, whites, and Latinos use marijuana at roughly the same rates. But in California today, blacks are 4 times more likely to be charged with marijuana possession than whites. Latinos, almost 2 times more likely. Now, we all know that innocuous things have been used to arrest and criminalize people of color. Marijuana is no exception. This little plant has a racialized history and has consistently been used to pack the criminal justice system with black and brown Americans.
Public enemy number one in the United States is drug abuse.
Just say no to drugs.
The war on drugs had a hidden purpose. President Nixon saw the drug crackdown as a way to arrest blacks and anti-war protesters.
Who goes to prison for drug use are predominantly folks of color and people who are low income.
Let me see some hands.
Countless lives have been ruined for the use of a substance that a majority of Americans now think should be legal.
To me, it's completely silly and ridiculous that it's criminalized at the federal level.
This has gone on for far too long. In California, they leave it up to the police to decide who is possessing and who is selling. Which is the difference between an infraction and a felony.
You know, traumatizing people is not deterring crime or stopping crime.
Put it down, bro. Put it down! Down!
The good news is Prop 64 can help start us on a new path.
Here are some of the things Prop 64 lays out. It makes the possession and use of marijuana legal for adults.
It ends the incarceration of minors for marijuana violations.
It invests millions of dollars in services for our communities affected by the war on drugs.
Overall, marijuana arrests decreased by more than 80% in Washington, Colorado, and D.C. after marijuana was legalized.
We ought to be learning what we can from those states.
We have to own up to the fact we spent 40 years drumming the beat of this war on drugs, and we wasted $1 trillion, and I think this is where you start.
With one vote, we can start to put an end to this criminalization. Vote yes on Prop 64.
So that's California's Prop 64, and I think that they should vote yes on that one. And you'll hear how I feel about Arizona in just a few minutes. Speaking of Arizona, we're going to get into a little Arizona news. Here's an Arizona company who's partnering up in Maryland to grow cannabis, and they're having some problems.
A company interested in bringing medical marijuana to Washington County is running into some problems. Company officials say their operations will not begin anytime soon as they try to resolve some conflicts. WHAG's Nina Kapoor has more.
Hundreds of potential employees, one city's government, and people in need of specific medical attention are all on standby.
We are now just basically at the mercy of the Cannabis Commission and the state level.
Harvest Dispensaries, an Arizona-based company, and the town of Hancock are experiencing one road bump after another on their journey to bring medical marijuana to Washington County.
For now, there's still no mechanism in place for how to distribute the product and how doctors will prescribe and how people will get a card that allows them to use it.
To make matters worse, several companies were removed from the list of 15 pre-approved growers by the state commission due to a lack of geographic and racial diversity. Now one of these companies is suing the state cannabis commission for what they feel is unfair and illegal behavior. So the cannabis commission is dealing with that before they proceed to harvest final approval.
There was a concern about racial diversity and that there were not enough companies with people of color in executive positions chosen.
When the CEO of Harvest and Mayor Murphy recently met to go over last-minute preparations, they couldn't come up with a date to start moving the operations into the facility.
We don't have anything to tell people when they say, where do we apply for jobs or a tentative start date.
Harvest Dispensaries only received a pre-approval from the commission. They still need a final approval before they can move any further. A company that's ready to invest $11 million into this startup in small town is on hold indefinitely.
We're ready in Hancock. Let's go state of Maryland.
Reporting in Hancock, Nina Kapoor, WHAG News.
$11 million investment. That's some heavy bread. Also in Arizona, the Maricopa County has busted, allegedly, some criminals claiming to be legit medical marijuana business. It was a big warehouse. They were growing under the guise of growing for patients who lived out of the area. And here is this report, a big bust.
Criminals claiming to be a legit medical marijuana business ended up getting busted for a $14 million per year pot growing operation, and it could have exploded just like the one in New York City.
Yeah, that was just 24 hours ago. A firefighter died, nearly two dozen others were hurt, and today our Jason Valentine was with deputies as they raided warehouses filled with pot.
This grow house can make 1,000 pounds of pot every 90 days, and that would be one thing, but they're also making hash oil. That's why the fire department has to be here, because all the equipment they need to do that is super explosive.
Guns out, busting down doors at daybreak, but a good thing nobody had to fire a shot.
Plus you have hashish oil being made here.
Hash oil is the stuff in these jars, worth about 50 grand each. It's pot, cooked down to pure concentrate, and making it is dangerous, even explosive.
Pretty insane to think that something like that could go, you know, go on right across the street from where you are.
The sheriff says neighboring businesses were lucky. A lab not nearly as big exploded in the Bronx earlier this week, killing a New York City fire chief and hurting 20 others.
If that thing blew up, you're going to take down some other building. That's how big that is.
The sheriff's office spent months investigating the lab at two different warehouses south of Sky Harbor. A tough case to nail down because the growers were pretending to be a legit medical marijuana business.
Committing fraud, that's what they're doing.
According to the sheriff, the growers say they were caring for patients who live more than 25 miles from regular licensed dispensaries, which in theory would be legal. But in reality, sheriff says the patient addresses were all fake. In one case, 50 people registered at a single house in Apache Junction. I'm Jason Valentine, ABC 15.
Okay, and before we take a short break and come back with David Wisniewski and Jason Madar talking about Arizona's legalization, no on 205. Here is the wife, a story about the wife of Arizona Diamondbacks owner Ken Kendrick, who is the top donor against 205. And it's not for the right reasons to be against it, by the way.
Arizona could help the U.S. get a big paycheck if voters legalize recreational pot in November. Nine states are voting on this. If it passes, up to $7.8 billion could be injected into our country's economy. Frontier Financial is predicting the U.S. could stand to make more than $20 billion by 2020 if recreational marijuana passes. So who exactly supports legalizing recreational marijuana? Well, we looked at state elections data for Prop 205 and found anti-weed supporters have contributed almost four times more cash than pro-weed supporters. We caught up with a Tempe attorney turned independent who's donated $55,000 in the pro-weed effort.
It was not up until 2011-ish where I saw it having a positive impact in people's lives.
Steve White says certain cases have turned him pro-marijuana, like 7-year-old Xander Welton, who needed a federal court ruling to continue using a marijuana extract to treat seizures. On the anti-pot side, the top donor is none other than Randy Kendrick, the wife of Arizona Diamondbacks owner Ken Kendrick. She spent $100,000 opposing weed. We reached out for comment, have not heard back yet. To see our full analysis on weed contributions, visit abc15.com.
We'll be right back after this to talk to David Wisniewski and then Jason Madar about why no on 205 is important in Arizona. So we'll be right back after this.
It's all about the 420 MMJ Radio. The Medical Marijuana. The Medical Marijuana Radio.
Hey, this is Scott from Rare Dangness. You're listening to Medical Marijuana Radio.
And we're back and online today. Once again, my favorite person in Arizona, David Wisniewski, who is the executive director of Safer Arizona. And what's the tagline there?
We're a cannabis legalization political action committee working to end prohibition in Arizona.
Fantastic. Well, it's been very controversial in Arizona. There's only, you know, 4 or 5 weeks to go. Like 39 days, I think, is what people are saying. So tell me, what's the current status of the 205? There's good reasons to vote against it from what I've read.
Right. Well, the state of Arizona is torn in half in regards to cannabis consumers. I mean, we would think that any sort of legalization, all the consumers would be flocking towards it, and it would just be consumers versus the prohibitionists. But the consumers are extremely split because these people who have drafted this initiative did not have them in mind. They had their own bottom line in mind. So it's, in short, it's a really bad initiative. So there's a strong vote no organically, and there's also a big vote no coming from smoke shops and other parts of the community. So there are a couple reasons to vote yes, which are it will further national momentum because Arizona will have the illusion of legalization, and it will reduce arrests in simple possession. But that's about it.
It will also piss off Joe Arpaio, right?
Yeah, but I mean, he's still going to have his hands full because basically the bottom line is they're not removing prohibition. They're placing a law on top of prohibition, so whatever's not covered under their law defaults back to the felony prohibition, and a lot of that stuff is still within consumer level. So Sheriff Joe's still going to be running around busting cannabis consumers just as much probably as he is today with the lack of removing prohibition itself. Colorado, they already had some sort of decriminalization, so if you break the law over there, it's just a misdemeanor. So it's not so much of an incentive to hunt down cannabis consumers.
Mm-hmm. I'm looking at a chart that was online that I found, and it says here that less than 1 ounce of marijuana currently is 2 years at $150,000 fine, and now that would be legal. Less than 5 grams of marijuana concentrate would be legal. Now, why do you think they capped the concentrates at 5 grams? That doesn't seem like a good one to me.
Yeah, that's ridiculous. And then there's no threshold, so 5.1 grams puts you back on a prohibition, and you're getting felony for narcotics. I'm not sure exactly why they made that cap. I've heard speculation that there's this big grand conspiracy to control the concentrates market, and they're using that number in other states as well for some sort of tier suppression, mm-hmm. so we can't buy a certain amount. Similarly, with the 2.5 ounces, apparently that was set there so the caregivers couldn't buy a pound and get that discount on the pound, keeping the rest of the market higher.
So the actual amount of cannabis flower that one can have on them is going to stay the same at 2.5 ounces.
It's going to be dropped to 1 ounce for rec, because 1 ounce to 2.5 ounces is a fine.
Okay, but if you're caught with more than that, then you're going to have it like a $300 fine, it says.
Yeah, if you're caught with 1 ounce to 2.5 ounces, it's a $300 fine.
Okay, now cultivation. Tell me about what's in the law for people in rec to cultivate, and how does that affect the medical patients and their cultivation?
Initially, it's a good thing at face value, because you're supposed to be able to grow 6 plants and keep anything you grow off those 6 plants at your house. When you leave your house, you can only carry an ounce with you. And a lot of people, that's fine if that were exactly how it were going to be. However, they allow city councils to prohibit that home cultivation with a majority vote. If they consider it to be a nuisance, then all of Phoenix cannot cultivate now. And then once the big cities do it, the smaller cities are expected to follow suit. So it's going to be, we expect it to be a temporary grow provision at best, similar to the 25-mile rule, how everyone got to grow right away. But once the dispensaries popped up, people wouldn't be allowed to grow anymore. We expect right away people will start growing, but eventually, within the first year or so, city councils would be like, nope, this is a nuisance, nix it, and then bam, you have to go to the dispensaries.
Right, and there's no real definition of what is a nuisance from what I was reading, so they can pretty much make up anything they want.
Absolutely.
How does the rec plant count, you know, for people, you know, for recreational growing? How is that affecting the 25-mile rule in the medical program? Is there a 25-mile rule in rec, or does the 25-mile rule go away totally?
The 25-mile rule doesn't go away at all. Patients will still be prohibited from growing 12 plants if they're within 12 miles or 25 miles of a dispensary. However, now they're allowed 6 plants of recreational marijuana. So that kind of makes the 25-mile rule a little bit better, because you get half of it back, but the city councils can still prohibit that, making it pretty much the same way it is. But it's not going to be exactly the same way. Apparently, if the city councils do prohibit the 6 plants, it's not going to revert back to felony prohibition for 1 to 6 plants. It would be a civil violation of some sort, not an arrest.
So, but can a medical, licensed medical patient who's allowed, you said, to grow 12, can he add the 6 recreational plants and grow 18?
No.
No, okay.
Well, no, they wouldn't be able to do that. Most of the people who are patients are only going to be able to grow 6 plants, because they'll be living within 25 miles of a dispensary until they... I lost my train of thought. Until they get their grow. But if they live outside the 25 miles, they're allowed to grow their 12 plants. They can't get the additional 6 plants on top of that. That maxes out their 12.
Okay. Well, yeah, that I can understand that. You certainly, you know, with 6 plants, medical or rec, you certainly could grow enough if you're growing. I mean, I don't know what the outdoor thing is in Arizona, because it gets very hot there, but normally if you grow outdoors under the right conditions, you can grow enough one time a year to satisfy your needs all year long.
I think that it has to be in an enclosed and locked facility, so the plants probably won't get big enough to become these monsters that we see all over the internet, but you can still grow a lot of cannabis off of 6 plants indoors. So the one of the biggest concerns is that something that is happening today will continue happening under recreation. Is today patients who do grow their six plants, cops, detectives are alleging, okay, well, you were compliant with the AMMA, you just had your 12 plants and you grew as much as you could, and that's totally fine. But this doesn't look like you are being consistent with personal use. I'm going to allege you are in possession with intent to sell. You are now under arrest and facing mandatory prison time because your plants weighed more than 2 pounds. So that's happening to patients today. Total law-abiding citizens are getting arrested, getting raided, facing prison time just because cops think they're selling on the black market with zero evidence. So we expect the same thing to happen under Prop 205. You're growing your six plants. Cops think, oh, that's too much. You can't grow 2 or 3 pounds. What are you, crazy? You have to be selling. With zero evidence, they'll get an indictment, and you will be facing mandatory prison time.
So it really sounds like, you know, there's zero decriminalization in regard to this rec bill. It does say here, though, that under distribution and sale that you legally could give away less than 2.5 ounces to a person who is 21 years or older. That's correct, right?
You would be able to legally give away your ounce, but if you had 2.5 ounces, you're not supposed to have that. You're supposed to just have an ounce or less. Unless it's like, I guess, in your own home from what you grew.
Uh-huh. And what about for rec people? Obviously, if I come to Arizona every once in a while, and I could go into a rec shop, I guess, and buy something. Is there limits on what I can buy being out of state, or what are the limits in purchasing at a rec dispensary?
So that's another place where it allows you to legally break the law. Is it's not going to be like the medical program where they ration you and you can only buy 2.5 ounces. If you try to buy more, they won't sell it to you. But here you'll be able to dispensary hop as long as you're 21 and over and just get your ounce from this dispensary and that dispensary and that dispensary. So you can legally buy over your amount and commit a felony legally, mm-hmm. which is crazy. That's what happens when you get legalization in parallel with prohibition. You get scenarios where you can get arrested for obeying the law.
Yeah, I hear you. And there's other contradictory things here with 205 as well. And that is, one of them is, of course, the paraphernalia situation where I guess smoke shops are worried that they who have been in business for years and years and years are going to be subject to other conditions. Can you tell me about that?
Right. So this Prop 205 creates a Department of Marijuana, and their job is a bunch of things. One of them is issuing licenses. Another one is to regulate the advertisement of marijuana accessories, which is pretty much everything in a smoke shop. And it also includes hydroponic shops. So these smoke shops, they'll be selling them themselves, and they'll be able to manipulate the market to say, okay, well, you guys, you smoke shops, you guys have to only have a catalog. Put all your stuff in the back, just have a catalog sitting out. Or even say, you can only market your marijuana accessories online. Any way they want to regulate the advertisement, they can. And that is going to affect the bottom line of the smoke shops and hydroponic shops.
Why do the authorities want to have control over paraphernalia? I mean, there's nothing illegal about that.
They want to be able to sell it. This Department of Marijuana, it's composed of 3 dispensary owners and 4 people who aren't. But these 3 dispensary owners, all they have to do is convince one of these 4 people to do anything they want. But from the way it looks like it, they're trying to absorb the marijuana accessories industry themselves. So you have to go to a dispensary to get your marijuana accessories.
That just makes no sense at all in an industry that's been going on for 40 years. I mean, I used to sell papers and pipes and stuff when I worked in a record store in 1969 in California. I mean, smoke shops have been around selling cigarette papers and pipes and all this stuff for forever. I think it's ridiculous that they're trying to gain some kind of a monopoly by, you know, if a dispensary wants to sell papers and stuff, fine, it's convenient. Their customers are right there. I understand that. But to try to kill an industry that has been around for all these years, you know, with glass blowers and so forth, is really reprehensible as far as I feel anyway.
Yeah, it's gonna make the prices go up because it's already an oligopoly. They're already overburdened and can't accommodate their patients. So it's going to make the price go up, quality go down. But I am indifferent on whether it passes or fails because I wholeheartedly believe that we're going to get our 2018 campaign on the ballot and it's going to get voted in. And so the Prop 205, it doesn't even take effect right away. They expect it to take an effect September 1st, 2018. So that means that even if you vote yes, you're going to get 2 months to buy your store-bought, you know, marked-up cannabis from that oligopoly before our initiative makes the ballot. And if it's voted in, then it's going to be a marijuana wonderland. It's total decriminalization. It's probably going to be one of the best initiatives in our country has seen. So they're not going to be very happy if our initiative passes as far as these dispensary owners because they just spent millions to create a market that we just gave to the people.
Can you name those three dispensary owners that are involved with trying to, you know, put an oligarchy or a monopoly on the recreational? Who are they? Who are those three dispensaries?
We've got J.P. Holio from Arizona Natural Selections. All right, we've got Gina Berman from The Giving Tree, and then we've got Mark Steinmetz from Nature's AZ Medicines.
So these are the people that really are trying to put their fingernails into the rec world. You know, I can understand. I mean, according to 205, the medical dispensaries that are currently licensed will have first crack at going recreational. Is that right?
Right, and so the way it's set up, and the media is putting out that it's not going to go into effect until September 1st, but they can start issuing licenses well before that, and the first recreational store can start selling cannabis as early as March 1st, 2018. So since they keep telling the media September 1st, they could be saying, well, that's going to be at the latest, but if they fail to adopt rules for distributing licenses, then on September 1st, all of the dispensaries that are currently in good standing with the state will be allowed to start selling marijuana to adults 21 and over. So to me, it looks like that's a way for the medical industry to instantly absorb almost the entire rec industry overnight if they just don't adopt rules.
I see. So I said a few minutes ago that, you know, after reading all this, I could not vote for 205. It's not legalization. It's got too many restrictions. People still can go to jail and for different offenses that really aren't that wild or, you know, egregiously illegal. So this just doesn't sound or feel like a real recreational legalization to me.
It's not. It's a complete fraud. It's a perversion of legalization. I call it felony enforced corporatization.
Would you repeat that again? I got to grab that in my head.
I call it felony enforced corporatization.
Wow, that sounds like you really thought about that. That really describes it perfectly, David. It really does.
Hell yeah, it does.
So, real quick before we go, just so you guys are writing a new bill for 2018 that would really clean things up and make it right. This 205, you feel obviously it looks like it was rushed just to go with the flow and get legalization going, but it's not right. It just doesn't feel right to me. Now, I've had some conversation with Todd McCormick, who's a huge activist in California, about ALMA, the Adult Use Act in California. And on the other side of that, he convinced me that now's the time for California, that yes, there are some problems with ALMA, but it's better just to legalize it now and make changes later. And in reading the California stuff, I do get that, and I understand that, and I think it would be good for everybody if the California ALMA was passed, but not 205 in Arizona. I think it's terrible. What are the current polls right now?
Well, polls are going back and forth. We're seeing some that are like 50% are in favor, but I've seen polls as recent, Leah, is just a month ago, saying that only 39% were in favor. So really it's varying, but it's never really like a majority is supporting it this time around. But as far as a bad law passing now and changing it later, Arizona's got the Voter Protection Act, which means that we can't just do that. We have to file a new initiative. So if Prop 205 passes, our initiative is that new initiative we're filing to fix it. So if ours passes, it's just going to simply repeal Prop 205 and replace it with total decriminalization and legalization.
So that could happen. 205 could pass, and then you could still put your 2018 ballot measure on, and that could get rid of 205.
Right. We could repeal ours repeal theirs and replace it with ours in the same initiative.
Okay. That seems like the way to go, but I'm just, you know, going to go out on a limb and say that I, as a citizen, you know, in a neighboring state here in New Mexico, I would advise people in Arizona to vote no on 205. And that's my personal view and Medical Marijuana Radio's view as well. Before we go, how will 205 affect the medical industry?
Initially, 205 is not supposed to affect the medical industry. However, it takes the medical program out of the Department of Health Services and puts it into the hands of the Department of Marijuana, where there are no doctors or medical professionals. It's just a bunch of business owners who are trying to make money off the industry, mm-hmm. and they will be responsible for making new rules in regards to the program and how it's implemented. So they can't actually change Prop 203, but they are responsible for writing the new rules and how the program is implemented, which will affect patients' access to marijuana.
Well, I have yet to see a Department of Health in any medical marijuana state that knows shit about what they're doing, and the Department of Health have really been terrible when it comes to medical cannabis, and so, you know, maybe taking it out of their hands would be okay. You know, who knows? They just don't seem to be really on the ball. We've had problems here in New Mexico since day one. But, you know, David, I think you really explained things well. Any final words on this?
Yeah. So even if Prop 205 passes or fails, we are filing our initiative November 9th. So we're looking for volunteers. And so if there's anybody in Arizona who'd like to volunteer or give us a campaign contribution, they can do so at saferarizona.com.
Are you going to vote?
I'm not going to vote. I'm indifferent. So I'm gonna, whatever way it goes is whatever, because I believe ours is going to make the ballot, and we're just going to take it down if it goes up.
Okay, and that was David Winooski's views. And we're now going to talk for about 10 minutes or so with Jason Medar, who is another big activist in Arizona. Here's Jason. And online I have Jason Medar, who is with Arizonans for Mindful Regulation, and is very involved with the no on Prop 205 in Arizona. So why no? We just spoke to David Wisniewski about it a whole bunch, and it doesn't seem like it was well thought out, and it just doesn't seem like it should be passed.
I completely agree with you. Yes, we're very much against the Prop 205 here in Arizona. When I say we, our group formed an Arizonans for Mindful Regulation, and from that we also formed a new campaign called Marijuana Consumers Against Fake Marijuana Legalization. And just as the name implies, we're a group of thousands of marijuana consumers here in Arizona who feel that Prop 205 actually does more harm than good. And so there are obviously a number of reasons why we believe that, of course. And of course, I'd be happy to go into a brief list of those reasons.
Sure. We did cover some of those with David. But yeah, give me, you know, your most egregious reasons why this should go down.
Well, To start at the top, Prop 205 could possibly destroy the Arizona medical marijuana program. Prop 205 gives the medical marijuana program, it takes it from the Department of Health, where it's currently at, and it gives it to the new marijuana department that would be formed under Prop 205. And that marijuana department would be run, in part, by the medical marijuana dispensary owners. So the obvious concern is that there's a conflict of interest in allowing the people who make the money to also make the rules.
Absolutely a conflict of interest. I mean, there needs to be regulation. And these profiteers that are currently in the medical industry to make profit and not really there for the patients and for what it is, these are the people that need to be regulated. And to sort of have the monkeys running the zoo is not something that is good.
I completely agree with you. And frankly, we think it's irresponsible to sacrifice the rights of seriously ill medical marijuana patients in order to allow people to use marijuana recreationally. Of course, we are pro-legalization 100%. But we believe that you should legalize marijuana and still protect seriously ill medical marijuana patients. And so that's one of our biggest reasons.
Absolutely. I'm all for it with that. I've been talking for years that with legalization, we need to preserve our medical industry. They're two different industries. They have different needs and different products for people, and they should not be lumped in with each other like currently is happening in Washington, and Colorado is having problems with their medical as well. It just seems like 205 is like exactly what you say, Jason. It's fake legalization because it's not freeing the plant. It's putting restrictions on growing. It's restrictions on how much you can have and so forth. So go ahead. Tell me some more stuff about why no.
Well, yes, and absolutely. And just to speak one more thing to that point, people ask all the time, how likely is it that that would happen under Prop 205, that the medical marijuana program would be destroyed? And as you said perfectly, Larry, we can look to other states to answer that question for us. We've seen in Colorado, Washington, Oregon, and Alaska that medical patients have been unhappy with the effects of recreational legalization bills. And so absolutely, that's a very important point. One of the other important points, the most important points, is that Prop 205 does not include meaningful marijuana decriminalization, meaning that most of the felony penalties remain in place under Prop 205. As a perfect example, Prop 205 allows you to grow 6 marijuana plants, but then says that if you grow a 7th marijuana plant, that it's a Class 4 felony, likely with a mandatory prison sentence.
That's not legalization. That's not freeing the plant. And this sounds like hastily written, and it doesn't make sense.
Right. Well, and another great example is that in Prop 205, you can have 5 grams of marijuana concentrates. But if you possess 6 grams of marijuana concentrates, or more than 5 grams, rather, you would be charged with, again, a Class 4 felony for possession of narcotics. And so, again, we think this is extremely inappropriate. And people ask all the time, well, why didn't the Prop 205 campaign include decriminalization? And we asked them that question numerous times. Ultimately, the answer we were left with was that marijuana decriminalization was left out of Prop 205 because leaving the felony penalties in place for marijuana sales and things like that would cause the street value of marijuana to remain high, artificially high, and thus the retail value would also be able to remain artificially high. And also they said that the felony penalty would, of course, create a serious incentive for people to buy from the dispensaries rather than buying from a dealer. And while that's true, our position, AZFMR's position, is that nobody belongs in prison with murderers and rapists for any marijuana crime. And so obviously you can see why we certainly believe that Class 4 felonies and mandatory minimum prison sentences are extremely inappropriate when we're talking about legalizing marijuana.
You know, when I went to your website which is at nofakelegalization.com, which really spells this out well. And I advise everybody, whether you're in Arizona or another state that might be legalizing in the future, to really go through this and read it. Because I read your full explanation, and I also read your highlighted explanations. And then I went to the yes on 205. There's like no reason to vote yes on it. It's just terrible. And the fact that how did it get on the ballot?
Well, the Prop 205 is being paid for by the Marijuana Policy Project and the medical marijuana dispensary owners here in Arizona. And I'll get to the reason for why that is in just a minute. But they're paying millions of dollars to get Prop 205 passed, and they paid $3 per signature to get the amount of signatures required in order to get this on the ballot.
Is that legal?
It is.
It's legal to pay somebody to sign a piece of paper to get a measure on the ballot.
Well, you can't pay people to sign, but you can pay people to collect signatures. Uh-huh. And so that's what they were doing. They were paying professional signature collectors.
Sorry, folks, we got a little...
To go around and collect signatures, and for every signature that that person got, they received $3.
And so how many signatures were needed?
They needed 150,000 signatures that were valid voters, and they collected somewhere in the ballpark of 260,000. So they had plenty. There were plenty of paid petitioners that were collecting signatures to get that on the ballot.
I wonder what percentage of those signatures actually realize what they were signing for. Because, again, when I read yes on 205, there's like really no reason to vote yes on it. What are the polls looking like currently that you've seen?
Well, the most recent polling, the last poll was somewhere around 51-52% in favor of legalization. But all of the past five polls for legalization in Arizona have hovered right around 50-50. Now, that's talking about general legalization. People, when they're participating in these polls, they're not asked specifically about the language of Prop 205. Rather, they're asked if they support marijuana legalization in general. But even with that being said, we've continued to hover around 50-50 for polling.
You know, I'm surprised that the MPP has taken this stance and put up money for this. What's in it for them? It just sounds like such a bad measure.
Well, it is. We'd actually worked with MPP and the dispensaries when they were writing Prop 205 to try and ensure that they included the most important marijuana consumer protections. And of course, as we know, they did not.
They're not there.
And unfortunately, we were told that unless we paid for the ballot initiative, we wouldn't be able to influence the language of the initiative. And as I've already mentioned, the medical marijuana dispensaries are paying millions of dollars for Prop 205. And so, of course, they were forced to, MPP was forced to go with the language that the dispensaries wanted. Now, there was actually a rift between MPP and the medical marijuana dispensaries about a month before they filed their initiative with the Secretary of State. And the reason for that was over a difference in opinion over the language of what is now Prop 205. For example, one of the big contentions was that MPP actually wanted to include grow rights, and unfortunately, the medical marijuana dispensaries refused to include grow rights. They felt that it would take away from their business.
And, you know, that's an attitude that some other medical dispensaries that are here in New Mexico that also have ties in Arizona have been talking about. They have been trying to come down on personal patient licenses who are allowed to grow, thinking that's cutting into their profits. And these are people that are just about profits and about rec and not about medical. So it's really a crappy deal. Final thoughts, Jason?
Well, there's a few other things, and I'll breeze through them. Prop 205 could also destroy Arizona's smoke shops. That's why all of Arizona's most prominent smoke shops are behind our Vote No on Prop 205 campaign. Mm-hmm.
And that's silly. I went over that with David a few minutes ago, and it just makes no sense. These are businesses that have been around for 50 years and should be allowed to sell paraphernalia. I mean, part of the Linen, Air, and Compassionate Act here in New Mexico, which is the Medical Cannabis Act here, is that, you know, paraphernalia is not illegal. And for them to try to look, if a dispensary wants to sell paraphernalia, fine, let them sell it. It's their customers are in there. They're buying their medicine or they're buying their rec at the same time. But to take it away from people that have been, in this business for years and years and years is pretty dumb and makes no sense.
You're absolutely right. Another thing is Prop 205 also includes fake marijuana grow rights, is what we call it. As I mentioned earlier, Prop 205 says that you can grow 6 plants if you're over the age of 21. But it also says that a city or county can ban marijuana growing if they consider it to be a nuisance. And of course, in this case, it would be a city council, which would be a handful of city council members who would be making this decision. And so we're convinced that the vast majority of cities here in Arizona would exercise their authority to ban marijuana growing.
So even though 205 says you can grow 6 plants, if each individual city or county, whatever it is, wants to ban growing, they can do that. So that, you know, that's again, that's not freeing the plant. It's not giving the rights to the people.
It's fake grow rights is what we call
that's
it.
That's right. So everybody, it's nofakelegalization.com. Go there and read the outline and read the full explanation, your Arizona residents. And again, voting no on this seems to be the right thing to do. David said that he's indifferent because no matter what, if this thing does pass now, you guys and he are going to go ahead and do another one in 2018 that could turn 205 around, correct?
Well, we are. But the problem is that if Prop 205 were to pass, unfortunately, these medical marijuana dispensary owners that are paying for the monopoly that Prop 205 gives them, they would actually fight against us, and they would spend millions of dollars to fight against us from changing any of the language in the marijuana law that would affect their profits. And as I already mentioned, things like decriminalization, removing felony penalties, that takes away from their profits. Things like allowing more licenses, that takes away from their profits. So the problem is that if we try and fix Prop 205 later, we'll actually face a lot of resistance from these very dispensaries that get the oligopoly on the marijuana industry. Not to mention that if the smoke shops in Arizona are destroyed, we can't undo that damage. If the medical marijuana program is destroyed, we can't undo that damage either. Prop 205 also allows anybody's employer to fire them if they use legal marijuana, and we can't undo that damage either.
Yeah.
And so there's a lot of permanent damage that we wouldn't be able to undo later. But of course, we can't give up on marijuana consumers, and we know that.
Yeah.
That's why we've been activists for so long. But, there's, of course, a lot of – and another concern, of course, would be that once marijuana is legalized in general, it would be hard to get some of the public support for another legalization bill unless we really inform people about all the flaws of Prop 205.
Well, you certainly have done a great job of doing that, Jason Madar, and I thank you for that. And I wish no on 205 luck, on November 8th. And thanks for your hard work. And we'll have you back on afterwards and maybe get some comments on what happens or not. So
yes, definitely. Thank you. And like you already mentioned, we're going to be doing our own legalization bill next year. So I'd love to come back and talk about that because, again, we're not just telling people to vote no on Prop 205. We're telling people to vote no on Prop 205 and vote yes on AZFMR's initiative in 2018 instead.
Fantastic. And we'll have you back, I'm sure, many times between now and 2018. Thanks very much, Jason Madar.
Thank you, Larry.
We'll be right back after this.
That I know just came from Colombia. She smiled. because I did not understand. Then she held out some marijuana, huh-huh. She said it was the best in all the land. And I said, no, 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 I don't smoke it no more. I'm tired of waking up on the floor. No, thank you, please, it only makes me sneeze. Then it makes it hard to find the door. Came from Mallorca, Spain. She smiled because I did not understand. Then she held out a 10-pound bag of cocaine. She said it was the finest in the land. And I said, no, 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 I don't, no more. I'm tired of waking up on the floor. No, thank you, please, it only makes me sneeze. Then it makes it hard to find the door. Tennessee, oh, he smiled because I did not understand. Then he held out some moonshine whiskey, oh, he said it was the best in all the land. And I said, no, 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 I don't drink it no more. I'm tired of waking up on the floor. No, thank you, please, it only makes me sneeze. And then it makes it hard to find a door. It only makes me sneeze, and then it makes it hard to find a door.
The medical marijuana. The medical marijuana.
I want to thank David Wisniewski and Jason Madar for really explaining why no, 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 no on 205 is what should be done in Arizona and work towards 2018. It's just too many bad things about that. Also want to thank my two radio mentors, both with the initials HS. Thank you for your inspiration. If you'd like to be a guest, if you have a product in the cannabis industry, you have a website, a business, you're an activist, you're a patient, you want to tell us how cannabis is helping you, write us at info@mmjradio.com. Again, that's info@mmjradio.com. If you'd like to hear some of our past shows, we've been doing this for 7 seasons. We've done about 400 shows so far. It's medicalmarijuanaradio.com or mmjradio.com. My YouTube channel is LSLove88. On SoundCloud and Spreaker, it's MMJ Radio. We're on CannabisTube.net. We're on Spreaker with Time for Hemp, and also on iHeartRadio on the Time for Hemp Broadcasting Network. Also on OnNow TV, channel 937, and also heard on 420radio.org.
Shalom.